Welcome to the next lecture in the series of Struggle to Success Journeys in Law. Over the past few months, we have heard some very inspiring stories and lifetime stories of quite a few of our senior advocates who have come and shared with us their journey, their struggle, their insecurities, and how what they have achieved today is only a culmination of all those years of struggle and hard work. And the word struggle need not always have a very negative connotation. It is a process which can be enjoyed, which can be cherished over a period of time. And our speaker for the day is one such person who went through his own struggle, his own dilemmas, his own insecurities, but never did that struggle ever leave him in any manner bitter. He always enjoyed the journey, and today also, you never see Freddy without a broad smile. So he's always continued, he's the whole product at the end of that struggle, is a very pleasant person who's always been very happy with the entire process. Mr. Divetri came without any legal background and without anybody in his family in the field of law. He came from, as we say, middle class upbringing, and he has had a great deal to share. He'll have a great deal to share with us, which will be an inspiration to all our members, particularly our younger members of the bar. So we are looking forward to hearing from Mr. Divetri. We really thank him for sparing time and accepting our invitation to come and share his thoughts with our members. I now request our President, Dr. Sathe, to please address our members.
Good evening, friends. I'm very happy to welcome my friend Freddy this evening with us. As Dr. Saraf mentioned, we started this program of lectures on the lawyers who have achieved success in legal profession, but who had started from non-legal background, or in other words, people who are not born with silver spoon. And that struggle is always interesting and inspiring, and a role model for young junior lawyers, law students, to hope and dream that without any backing, without any background, you can and you will achieve something which has been achieved by a person who is a role model, whom we have been introducing in this series. This evening, I'm particularly happy to welcome Freddy, because he is not only a legal, he's not only the legal luminary now, but he had various other facets. One of them is, of course, he has a wacky sense of humor. The other is, I have actually seen him before I joined legal profession. And one day, I was in Justice S.K. Desai's court in court number 43. And somebody mentioned that, please keep back the matter, Mr. Divetri is appearing. So Justice S.K. Desai remarked, oh, he must have gone to Brebant Stadium to give commentary. So that was his first passion before he became lawyer. And I always tell him that he left his passion of cricket at the most opportune time in 1991, when the entire cricket in the entire world was revolutionized with Mark Mascarenhas and World Tale. Freddy left cricket to be in law permanently. Now, that's Freddy. Freddy is, of course, a keen gardener, and I have visited his garden and seen him. He, of course, will accuse me of something which I did not do for him in his garden. Today, somebody said in a jocular way, there is a jurisdictional issue for Freddy being here in the series that struggles in legal profession. So somebody asked, looking at Freddy, can you think that he will ever struggle to do anything? So that's my dear friend Freddy. So we are all anxious to hear him. So here is Freddy for you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sathe. May I now request Mr. Divetri to please address our members.
Hi, friends. It was the way I started in 1972 on Sports Roundup, when I began all my programs with this expression, hi, friends. And I'm using it here today after a very, very long time. At the very outset, I think I must thank the association for this opportunity to interact with young members of the bar. I see some of them are not so young, but we'll forgive their presence here. And also, I think, an opportunity to thank and to congratulate this team of Milan Sathe, Nitin Thakkar, Birendra Saraf, and the entire team for having really done wonders with this association. They've done a superb job of reviving this association and making it one of the premier associations again in the country, which we have. Coming to today's topic, struggle to success, they've already, I think, taken away from me some of the things that I wanted to say in their opening remarks. They've already presaged what I was going to say. Because when you speak of struggle to success, both struggle and success, which are the two key words in this, are relative terms. Struggle may mean various things to various people. I know of people who struggle with 10 briefs a day, and they struggle as to which court to go to and where. I know of people who struggle for their next brief. So there's a qualitative difference between one struggle and another. And it is not always, I mean, it's de rigueur to say that I struggled at the bar in my early years. Of course, we all struggled at the bar. But these struggles were of different intensities. These struggles were of different dimensions. Some of us struggled more than others. Some of us struggled less than others. But therefore, when you speak of struggle, as I hope my story will unfold in, I mean, you've subjected yourself to all this, you'll see that the struggle was very, very, how shall I say, a happy struggle. Because frankly, in my experience at the bar, if I were to think back, I would probably think of only two people of the thousands I've met would be persons who I personally would not like to be associated with. Otherwise, everybody at the bar has been exceptionally helpful and exceptionally good to start off with. So also, when you say success, I don't know, what is success? Success is somebody else's perception of what you've achieved. And I assume that since I've been invited to speak and I'm standing before you and speaking, I assume that somebody somewhere thinks that I have been successful, no matter what I think of that. But I have a different view. But today, unfortunately, or maybe fortunately, we measure success only from the perspective of how much money a lawyer has made. The wealthiest lawyer is deemed to be the most successful. Not always necessarily so. Some of the greatest lawyers may not have made tons of money, but they were very great lawyers. And maybe it's time now to sort of redefine the notion of success in our profession. As far as journey is concerned, I don't think there can be any dispute. Of course, we started on that journey. And as they said in Sound of Music and Doremi, I suppose the best place to start on any journey is to start at the very beginning. And frankly, for me, my beginning, and it's a very dramatic recollection, because for the last 2 days I've been trying to gather my thoughts to talk for this talk. My journey, frankly, began on a walk. On a walk down a side lane in Bandra, about maybe 45, 47 years ago. Hand in hand with my then girlfriend, who later became my wife and is still my wife for 42 years. And I had just passed my BA honors from St. Xavier's College with Eco and Stats, which was the in thing in those days. And everybody wanted to know what to do after college. I know some people, and I admire them, who knew exactly what they wanted to do. Somebody wanted to be a doctor, pursuing a doctor. Somebody wanted to be an engineer, wanting to go to IIT. Frankly, I didn't know what I wanted to do. So I was in a dilemma. I said, "Shun kariya? What to do?" So I said, "Let's see. Let's while away some time. Let's go to Kalina to do my MA with EcoStats." I attended college from June to about September or whatever. back in Kalina. Bombay University used to have its lectures in Kalina. And frankly, the lectures just flew over my head. Not that we attended too many, we attended one or two lectures. We had very good professors. We had Professor Brahmanan, who was a renowned world scholar in economics. But frankly, statistics and economics just didn't interest me. It just flew over my head. So I found that I was playing table tennis most of the time, and that instead of my economics improving, my backhand began to get better. And I said to myself, surely I'm not going to become a professional table tennis player. So what am I doing here? And we were sort of walking along and reflecting on this when my then girlfriend said, why don't you do law? Come to government law. I'm there. At least we can meet in the canteen, no? So I said, okay, chalo, let's do law. I mean, if you're saying we can meet, maybe we can meet more often. So let's go to the law college, let's do law. And in those days, you didn't need much. I had the percentages to get in. So I got in into what was known as the October batch, not the regular June batch. And the October batch was sort of looked down upon, failures, you know, sort of they didn't come in June, they came in October. But anyway, I joined the October batch, which was morning college, 7:30 in the morning. And we did reasonably well in college, passed out. And that's how, frankly, I became a lawyer. And as that famous author said of one of our prime ministers, you might describe me as an accidental lawyer, because law was not my chosen or my first chosen subject. I drifted into the law, and therefore I'm not sure, despite all my years of experience, that I am in a position to either preach to you, to lecture to you, or to give you a bhashan or advice. So I'm going to try and refrain from being preachy to you, which many seniors tend to do sometimes when talking down to juniors. And what I propose to do is really just share a few experiences that one has had over these last 43 years that one has been at the bar. You know, when we were in school, we had these aptitude tests. Some chap would come and give you a whole questionnaire. Do you like this or do you like that? And do you want to do this or do you want to do that? And at the end, they would tell you you're suited for this or you're suited for that. And strangely, in my case, the aptitude test turned out to be one, journalism, and two, law, because of language, I assume. And I've been very fortunate that I've been able to do both in some measure with reasonable success. Okay, so we had passed out of college. Frankly, we had not even passed out of college. I was in my third year. And I said, okay, I'm doing okay in college. Let's start getting some practical, practical work experience. So what to do? We knew no one. I mean, Professor Muchhala was our professor for drafting pleading. Couldn't really walk up to him and ask him anything. So an uncle of mine, I had no background in the law. I'm a first generation lawyer. So an uncle of mine knew an eminent senior counsel at the bar. And he said, ke maro nallo neviu cha jara ene kethe mukhi apni, just find him some place in some law firm. And the next thing I knew, that eminent counsel said, let him go to a firm called Jamsetji Rustamji Devidas Jani and Merchant. I had never heard of the firm before. I thought that if I was to join the profession, let me go to some well-known firm like Mulla and Mulla or Crawford Bailey or Little and Company or something like that. But Jamsetji Rustamji Devidas Jani and Merchant was a complete stranger to me. I had never heard of it before. It turned out to be one of my most or the greatest learning experiences that I have had. And principally because it was a small firm, and it just threw you in at the deep end. There was no time to learn anything. We were still in the third year of college. There was no time to learn anything. And the first real big matter that I did while working with Jamsetji Rustamji was a mammoth. It was a gigantic litigation. And I'm amazed. They used to be solicitors for the state government and all the organizations of the state. And MSFC, Maharashtra State Farming Corporation, was one of their clients. And there was a huge litigation involving the fixation of sugar prices for private sugar factories. Now, there were nine private sugar factories, and price had to be fixed for 7 years. So effectively, you were doing 63 long causes, because each year, each factory was a trial. Evidence had to be led, etc. And there was an arbitration held just across the road here in the Industrial Assurance Building on the first floor before a panel of three arbitrators. And on our side, we had Mahendra Shah, Salil's father, one of the most wonderful lawyers you can ever have. And we had Rafiq Dada, who was then a relative junior. And of course, me, the bachcha of the lot, still in college and trying to cope. And on the other side, you had the cream of counsel. You had Fali Nariman, who was leading counsel. You had Anil Diwan. You had Temton Andhyarujina. And you had Ghulam Vahanwati, four of the leading counsel. And the three eminent solicitor firms, there was Firoz Shah of Daftari Ferreira, Dandekar, there was Mulla and Mulla Popat, and there was Jagdish Desai of Kanga and Company. And this went on, it occupied 2 years of my life. We worked very, very hard. I used to work till 3:30 in the morning and be back in office by 9:30. Very often Rafiq also stayed back. Because in those days you didn't have computers, you didn't have, it was all cyclostyling and typing. And there was a Mazda typist, I think, who must have made a fortune and become a millionaire with the number of cyclostyling and Xeroxing that we used to give him, piles. And remember that if anything had to be changed in any draft, you couldn't do it like today, just say delete and add a new thing. You had to do the whole blessed draft again. So into my mind, what became the most precious commodity was those whiteners. Because then at least you could whiten things and not, it saved you the trouble of, you know, changing the whole page. And you were all the time paginating and stapling and getting briefs in order. And this went on, as I said, for 2 years. But it led me to two very, very interesting experiences. You know, Fali and Mahendra Bhai were friends at the bar. But when it came to arguing, they were the fiercest competitors. They would be at each other's throats, literally. I wouldn't say shouting, but arguing their case and sort of being very fierce with each other. This would start at about 11 o'clock. In those days, Maharashtra Sugar used to have an office on the fourth floor of that same building. It was one of those private companies, which was against whom we were appearing, whose price had to be fixed. And Kanga and Company in those days had some arrangement with some lady where lunch would be brought to Kanga and Company every day. So Kanga had arranged that instead of bringing it to Kanga, it would be brought to Maharashtra Sugar. And every day, believe me, when it was 1:30, Fali would turn to Mahendra Bhai, no matter how fiercely they had argued, and say, Mahendra, aaje chal upar majana dhokla cha. Ke aaje gano majani, aaje to puri cha. And Mahendra Bhai would say, ah, chalo, chalo, let's go. Rafiq and I would often look at each other after this sort of clash in court. Are we supposed to sit together and have lunch with these people? But it just, lesson number one was what they said, you don't need a godfather in the profession. Lesson number two was that no matter how fiercely you contest matters in court, I don't think it should ever come in the way of your personal equations. And this was an object lesson in that. The other was, and very interesting, we examined about maybe 25 or 30 witnesses, all accountants of cooperative sugar factories. You know, factories, sugar was a controlled commodity, Essential Commodities Act. We had cooperative sugar factories, most of these politicians, Nifad and Faltan, and those, we went to all these places. And of course, in those days, we were interested in the sugar cane. Today, we are more interested in the product of the sugar cane. And we examined all these accountants, because the price of the private sugar factory would be based on the price of the cooperative sugar factory. So these accountants would come and they would be cross-examined. And Mr. Nariman was very good in arguing. He was superb, India's leading. But he was also very good and very forceful in cross-examination. So these chaps would literally sort of shiver and give all the wrong answers in many ways. One day, there was one tough fellow who came from NIFAD. And in those days, we used to prepare his proofs. We had to sit with the witness and prepare his proofs. What was he going to say? And today, you have this evidence in chief. In those days, we called it proofs. And I said, look, he will shout at you, but you don't get nervous. He said, no, I am not nervous. Me Marathi madhe bolto. I go, what? He said, I know English, but I'll say I want to talk in Marathi. So I said, very good idea. Why don't you do that? Believe me, I put it to Mahendra Bhai. So Mahendra Bhai said, good idea, chalo. We'll, you know, again, a senior accepting some junior suggestion. So we put him into the box. And believe me, it just dissolved the entire cross-examination. Because the counsel would ask his question in English. Chairman, Justice, retired Justice N.D. Kamath, who then translated into Marathi for the witness. The witness, of course, understood what was being said in English also. The witness then would answer in Marathi, and then it would be translated for Fali or for whoever was the cross-examining counsel into English. So it worked as a brilliant strategy. And from then on, everybody was very comfortable. We ultimately succeeded. I mean, I got my third year result almost simultaneously with the award that we won. But I think the entire experience also left one with the feeling that there is really, in this profession, no substitute for hard work. I mean, I know how much we slogged during those years, sitting up, as I said, till 3:30, and that's a habit that has continued right through. I mean, even today, even for some, when there are matters which have to be read or there are more than a couple of new briefs to be read, what do? You have to get up at 3:30 in the morning and read them. And I really genuinely believe that no matter how clever you are, no matter how glib of tongue you are, ultimately it is the hard work that you put in that will pay you dividends. And I mean, it's not meant for these elderly people sitting here, but it's certainly something that somebody, I'm diverting from my promise not to lecture to you. And sometimes you wonder, you know, why do some people succeed at the bar and why do others don't? I mean, I have seen people who have been brilliant, good minds, not succeeding at the bar. And I've seen people who you would think are okay, doing very well at the bar. And frankly, I have no answer. I mean, I think it's a lot depends on your luck. But all my years at JRD, really, it was at 650 rupees a month, which was not a bad sum then. So I mean, when you say struggle, I mean, it wasn't as if you were on the street in poverty, you had a roof over your head and all that. But 650, when you look at it in perspective, in 1976, 77, a Coke bottle cost 1 rupee. The US dollar, the rupee to the dollar, was 1 rupee, $1 to 5 rupees. Today it's what, 73 rupees. So you look at it in perspective, 650 was not such a bad thing. And you know, after a time, you face this dilemma. What do I do? Do I continue here with the attorney's firm? Many of you probably face it. Do I continue here in the solicitor's firm? Do I switch over to counsel practice? And this sort of dilemma really eats you up. You spend sleepless nights. Am I doing the right thing? Am I doing the wrong thing? My firm was very keen to retain me, and they offered me an incentive. They said, we'll increase your salary to 3,500 rupees and make you a paid partner. And it was very tempting. I just got married, kid on the way. 3,500 was a lot of money. And yet something said that, no, I don't want to spend the rest of my life stapling and numbering briefs. I don't want to spend the rest of my time paginating. I don't want to spend the rest of my life instructing others. I want to get up and argue in court. And I think that overriding sort of emotion made one switch from being a paid sort of employee in a law firm to being counsel. I had whole lot of insecurities. Who will ever brief me? I mean, would I ever be briefed by anybody? There were so many young people around who were far more intelligent. But by the grace of God, things worked out. I joined Chamber Number 1, and I'm glad one of my colleagues, at least from Chamber Number 1, has deigned to come in here, because he added a lot of fun to what we did in Chamber Number 1. I'm not going to tell you everything that we did in Chamber Number 1, but it was a superb chamber. I joined Bami Zaiwala, and the head of the chamber was Karsaji Baba, who was a very, very colorful character. I'm not going to tell you any of his stories some other time, but a very colorful character. We had, in the broader chamber, we had Iqbal Chagla, we had Niranjan Vyas, Vatsal Chhatrapati, all very good people, all very helpful to us. And we were completely and totally irreverent to them. I mean, I sometimes wonder that if my juniors ever spoke to me, the way that we spoke to those people, I don't think I would be able to take it. We were completely irreverent to them. I mean, it was all on a sort of one-to-one basis. I see a lot of juniors today, and I really admire them. Some of them argue brilliantly. Some of them argue so well. And I look back to my days, and I feel that today's juniors and people at that comparative stage of your profession, I think that today's juniors are far smarter than we ever were same age. And you know, shortly after I joined as a counsel, the initial work was all basically, for me at least, bank work. In those days, these are all pre-DRT days. It was a lot of bank work. Little and Company used to send drafting briefs, and we sort of, you found out mortgage, pledge, hypothecation, whatever, some set kind of pattern to the whole thing. And then there was a time when there was a special assignment of only bank work. I don't know, Nitin will remember this, and Justice Raleigh was the one who first took it up in courtroom 37. And at the time when this was announced, you know, a special assignment of a judge being assigned only banks, because banks were complaining that our matters were not being done. I was engaged in a long cause suit before Justice Agarwal, and I was being led by a gentleman who's now he's in New Zealand, Kersi Khambata. It was the ST Adwani versus Syndicate Bank matter. And we were in the middle of a cross-examination before we were cross-examining a bank officer. When that evening Kersi called me up and he said, Johnny Dikra, I to cross-examine karoch, so I can't get out of this court, but kale there's a special bank suit assignment. The mari 30 matter ache court ma. Te tu jara attend karni. Attend karu? How do I go for 30 matters like this? I have not read a word. So next morning he dumped 30 briefs on me and he said, now go and argue them. I said, well, what do I argue? I haven't read a word. What are you expecting me to argue? So we walked into Justice Raleigh's court, who was a mild, good judge. And first matter called out, and I devised a sort of thing in my own mind. I just looked at the briefs quickly. And you know, either the A was the money prayer, B was what was the security, either hypothecation, mortgage, pledge, and then just fatka out, you know, this is the mortgage, why are they the property, the receiver must be appointed. And strangely, out of those 30, we must have got orders in about 20 and the rest were adjourned. And came back to Kersi and said, chalo, all your matters are worked out today. Of course, I never got any fees for those. And at that time, on Wednesdays, if I remember correctly, there used to be direction work. And directions were a junior's dream. Because if you got two or three briefs, you had these briefs were marked 2 and 3 GMs, which was about 30 to 45 rupees. So you got two or three of these briefs, and usually it was, you know, shall we send it to long cause, commercial cause, this, that, and the other. And judges then again, because they realized we were juniors, were very good. They would say, what is the matter about? And then you would struggle to speak a few words and say, no, something like this, something like that. You had hardly read much of it. And the judge would say, no, let's read the plain together. Why can't we read the plain together? Very kind judges who encourage juniors to sort of get into the sway of things. As juniors, frankly, we all, by and large, did a lot of list of dates. I mean, I must have done 1,000 list of dates. And we did propositions, which of course every senior just mutilated. I mean, by the time you gave him the proposition, and by the time you got it back, there was absolutely no semblance of what you had originally drafted. Mahendra Bhai, for example, with whom I worked quite a bit, used to use colorful pens, and he had the old school of drafting, even during the sugar days. And for example, Rafiq or myself had the what I call the shorter version of drafting. You know, each sentence, each day. Mahendra Bhai would add the whereases and the wherefores and the. And when you got back the draft, I mean, it was just like it was like a jigsaw puzzle, you know, something here, something there, something this. But this is, I suppose, how we learnt as juniors in trying to formulate. And I think I must tell you one thing, that we were advised when we were very, very junior, that you must not say no to any brief before any forum. Go to the tehsildar if you're asked to argue. Go to the collector. I've gone to the collector. I've gone to Mantralaya and argued before some undersecretary. And the reason was that they said that Ultimately, advocacy is a matter of persuasion. You have to persuade someone to your point of view and show him why and persuade him why your point of view is better of acceptance than the other guy's point of view. And I think that going before various people, I think helps you to develop this art of persuasion, which according to me is the bedrock of all advocacy. And the other is anticipation. I mean, it was such an experience because you prepared in a manner, thinking ahead, what will the judge ask me? And you anticipated sometimes what the judge would ask him. I mean, sometimes, of course, judges ask questions which nobody even his wildest dreams. We had a matter some years ago before a judge. We were doing an admiralty matter. And the ship was going to sail out. We were for a foreign P&I club. And the judge was doing admiralty for the first time. So he didn't know what a P&I club was, this protection and indemnity insurance company. And it was in some Norwegian company, 1859. And he said, what is the P&I club? I'm sorry, who are you? Who are the plaintiff? Are you a company? Are you a corporate? Are you a company under the company's law? Very technical judge. And we said, we are a P&I club from 1859. Hundreds of P&I clubs have sued in this. No, where's your certificate of registration? Certificate of registration of a company which was formed in 1859? So he said, no, unless you show me the certificate of registration. I think in those days it was fax. So a fax was sent to Norway. And said, where is your certificate of registration? So those Norwegians are completely zapped. They said, certificate of registration? Arey Baba, we have been here for over 100 years. What certificate of registration? So they looked at their whole office and the first fax came, sorry, we can't find our certificate of registration. Till some smart clerk said that the certificate of registration was hanging in the reception area in a frame. So they immediately did whatever, I don't know if they, on the fax, they photocopied it. At 3 o'clock we produced it, but we still lost the matter. And I remember we were so innocent in our earlier days that on one occasion, I was sitting in chambers and I got a particular brief, some small chamber summons or something, or maybe an adjournment brief. And about 10 minutes later, some clerk of another firm walked in and said, Sahib, I've already got a brief. I've got one brief. So my senior was sitting opposite me. He said, what's wrong with you? I said, what's wrong with me? I've already got a brief. How can I take a second brief for the same day? He said, don't be a fool. Just take as many briefs as you can for that day. We're really very, very innocent in our ways. And of course, in the initial years, there was a phase when you didn't have too much work. I mean, how much drafting can you do and how many drafting briefs can you get? So Mr. Dwarkadas and I, he had a bike at that time, a BSA. And we would go and spend a lot of our times at that Kulfi center at Chopati, devouring the Kulfis, and then go, there was a restaurant at Opera House on the first floor. And I recall, and I think if you ask him, he'll deny it, but between us, we had some 50 of those puri bhajis, or puris of the puri bhajis, which he reminds me to this day. And otherwise what we did was we went and sat in courts and listened to various senior counsel arguing, trying to imbibe something. And I recall a matter where we were in courtroom 31, which was called Tendulkar's court. And J.C. Butt, one of the giants of the bar, was arguing before a bench of Justice Kanya and Justice Kanade, the grandfather of the present Vishal. And it was something involving silver ingots, the silver things, some import, export, something, where the question of promissory estoppel was there. And Motilal Padampat's judgment had just come, Justice Bhagwati and Justice Tulzapurkar's judgment. So there was a judgment which the other side had cited, the state had cited, of Justice V.S. Deshpande, Chief Justice of the Delhi High Court, which was prior to Motilal Padampat, and which said that it was not enough for promissory estoppel that you changed your position. You must also show that there was some prejudice caused to you as a result of that change of position. Motilal Padampat said, no, sorry, it's enough to show that you had changed your position. It's not necessary to show that you had prejudice. So Justice J.C. Butt was trying to develop that point. And post Motilal Padampat, there was another judgment of the same judge of the Delhi High Court going back to his own judgment and ignoring Motilal Padampat, going back and saying that, no, you have to show prejudice. So J.C. Bhatt cited the first of Justice Deshpande's judgments of the Delhi High Court. Then he cited Motilal Padampat. And then, you know, he had glasses, and he would, very tall, 6'2". He used to wear his glasses at the edge of his nose. And he looked at the judges and he said, I am going to cite to you a judgment of the same judge who decided this matter before Motilal Padampat. And like a criminal returning to the scene of his crime, he now went back to his own judgment. And Justice Kanya was always a very timid soul, sort of. And he said, "Arey, Mr. Bhatt, do we need to use this language for a judge of the Delhi High Court? Why are we using this sort of a language?" And then there was a gentleman called Mr. Parsuram Puria. You will probably recall, it was just before Justice Pratap, we were all sitting in court, and in the central court, in court 46. And he was some clearance of goods. Somebody in some matter had just got an order saying you can clear your goods, but you will have to give a bank guarantee for the payment of customs duty or whatever in those days. Three matters later, Mr. Parsuram Puria's matter was called out. And identical, he claimed it was identical. And he told Justice Pratap, you know, in that matter you have given bank guarantee, in this also now bank guarantee, same facts, same this. So Justice Pratap must have read it. He said, no, I'm sorry, in your case it is completely different. The facts are, God knows, some fraud, something. So he said, in your case you will have to deposit the whole amount. I'm not going to give you a bank guarantee here. So Mr. Parsuram Puria was completely floored. He said, but if your lordship does that, who will come to my shop? What he meant was, who will come to my shop? And Pratap said, look, whoever comes to your shop or not, I'm going to pass a different order in your... There was a matter where Ashok Desai was appearing before Justice P.B. Sawant and Mrs. Manohar, division bench. And he was making some proposition. And Justice Sawant turned to him and said, Mr. Desai, I mean, this is a division bench of the Bombay High Court. You're making such an elementary proposition. Surely you can presume that we know this much of the law. He said, my lord, as an English barrister once told the judge, I made that mistake in the trial court. I don't want to repeat it here in the appeal court. And one more that I recall was Mr. Kalshikar. He was to be a barrister Kalshikar, if you recall. I mean, God forbid if you went after him to the loo, because he washed his hands with soap and water for at least 15 minutes to 20 minutes non-stop. So you had to stand in a queue outside. But that was not his only qualification. He was arguing a matter before the Chief Justice. I can't remember the bench now. And after some 2 hours of fairly laborious arguments, with the bench virtually dozing off, suddenly he turned up and said, now, my lord, I am going to my second point. So the Chief Justice looked at him and said, but what was your first point? You know, I was very lucky in my initial years to get arbitrations. A few, Temthan, Mr. Abhyarujana, led me in a matter, Punalur Paper Mills, with Atul Setalwad and Atul Setalwad and Gulam Bhanwati on the other side. Talking of Atul Setalwad reminds me of something I should be telling you. When I was with JRD, I used to handle a few of these matters. And there was a matter where somebody had attached the office furniture in the chairman of MSEB's office, Maharashtra State Electricity Board. We were for JRD. And this office was just across the road. MSEB was just here in those days. I don't know if it's still here, where the receiver's office was. Some chap had a decree, and so a suit was, or some writ was filed or whatever. And we briefed Atul Setalwad. It came up before Justice Rege in Court 6. I was qualified to sort of address the court, because till then I was only a student. And when the matter was called out, no sign of Mr. Setalwad, because he was arguing a matter here in Court 40. So I was in a panic. I ran up to this Court 40, between 6 and 40, and I saw Mr. Setalwad on his leg. So I asked everybody, can I interrupt him? So they said, oh, he's a hot-tempered chap, you better be careful. So anyway, I said, look, I have to, because I don't know what will happen when the matter is reached, when the matter reaches. So I sort of gently told him, Mr. Setalwad, that matter down before Justice Rege is reaching. So he said, take an adjournment. So I said, take an adjournment for what reason? What do I tell the judge? He said, not on my ground. So I didn't know what the hell, what is not on my ground. So I went down and I, you know, how, as I said, how innocent we were. When the matter was called out, I stood up and I told Justice Rege, I said, my lord, I'm asking for an adjournment. She said, why? Why are you asking for an adjournment? So I said, no, Mr. Setalwad is briefed in this matter and he has requested me to apply for an adjournment. And he said, but not on my ground. So, so Justice Rege burst out laughing. And he was a very kind soul, you know. He had that temperament where he tried to sort of convince counsel that counsel was wrong. And of course, no counsel was ever going to be convinced that he was wrong. But this debate would go on and on in Justice Rege's, court. And there was another occasion, I remember, and the actor in that is fortunately present here. I don't know, you've obviously heard of Justice S.K. Desai. He was quite a strong judge and was capable of making very caustic comments. So as juniors, you always sort of thought 20 times of how you're going to deal with the judge. When one day I was sitting in the library when Mr. Rashmikant, so it just started Federal and Rashmikant in those days, I don't know, 78, 77, God, no, when did you start? 80. And he came to the library and he said, Freddy, we have to make an application to Justice S.K. Desai in court 43. I think he was sitting with Justice Kantharia or Justice Dudhat, I can't recall the name. And the application is that we moved an execution application under Order 21. But it's for an order for payment of money. It's not a decree. So I said, what, Rashmi, yeah, you're getting me these useless matters. You know how S.K. will he'll really shout at us. How can you come under Order 21 with an order for payment of money? You have to have a decree. If you want to execute a decree, you can come under 21. Rashmi had just done his solicitors, I think. But otherwise, he doesn't read the CPC. But at that time, he had read the CPC for his solicitors exam. And he said, but Freddy, just look at section 36. So we looked at section 36, a two-line section, saying that an order for payment of money shall be executed in the same manner as a decree for payment of money. He said, oh, fine, let's go. So we went to court in those days, 2:45 was the post-lunch session. And Justice Desai walked in, we mentioned our matter, and I said what the facts were. And he came down on me like a ton of bricks. He said, you people don't read. This is an execution. How can it be an execution of an order? It has to be an execution of a decree. How can Order 21 apply? Give me a lecture for 5 minutes, which I heard him out. And then I said, Your Lordship, just see Section 36. And I must say, he read it. And if you recall, he immediately said, he said, you are absolutely right. I had overlooked the section. I took all the credit for it, but really it was Rashmi who had found this answer to this section 36. And there was yet another matter where a very eminent doctor, we filed a suit, just I had drafted it, Justice Variava, who was then at the bar, had settled it, where we asked for a receiver in an ongoing partnership. Now you can get a receiver for the asking in a partnership which is going to be dissolved, in a dissolution suit. But we said that my partner was acting in a manner oppressive to me, trying to drive me out of the firm. Now that is conduct which you should not tolerate. I want to continue in the firm and I want a receiver appointed in the case of a continuing partnership. Novel proposition, they briefed Mr. Chagla to lead us. And it came before Justice Painsay, who was taking ad interims. And any of you who appeared before Justice Painsay in ad interims, no ad interim lasted for more than 30 seconds. And this lasted for 10 seconds, because as soon as Mr. Chagla got up and said, continuing partnership receiver, he said, can't be. You can never have. Dismissed. Rejected. No ad interim. So we went in the appeal court. Appeal court was Justice S.K. Desai and Justice Bharucha. And Justice S.K. Desai, for all his, he was very astute, very clever. And he felt that, no, there must be some point in this. I mean, it can't be that these people are so irresponsible that they filed a suit like this. So while Mr. Chagla was arguing, he said, Justice Desai had this sort of habit of pulling his hair. He suddenly pulled one hair and he said, Mr. Chagla, it's a very good thing that the solicitor briefs the draftsman in the appeal court. So he'll explain to us what he looked up. And he looked at me and I froze. I didn't know what to say. So I got up and mumbled some nonsense about, you know, Lindley says this, it can be done in some exceptional case. And Lindley has cited those cases. So he said, show us those cases. I said, no, Mr. Chagla will do it for you. Mr. Chagla will show you whatever he has to show you. And I sat down. Ultimately, he adjourned it. He said, look up the law. And eventually it was settled. But it just shows his intellectual curiosity in wanting to know what the matter was. I had I had another experience where we were briefed, Zia Modi and I were briefed in the Podar matter with Mr. Ram Jethmalani. First time and only time that I have had the occasion to appear with him. It was in a 397-398 matter, operation and mismanagement. It was obvious with the conference at his chambers that he was not as familiar, let me say, with corporate law as he was with criminal law. So it was in a relatively a new subject to him. And we told him what the facts were. The other side was alleging operation and mismanagement. Believe me, we had a 3-hour conference that evening. 2.5 hours of those 3 hours, he kept asking, what is the allegation? Is it an allegation of fraud? And we said, yeah, it borders on fraud. They are saying this, they are saying some suppression, some board minutes, some mismanagement, whatever. And he kept pulling out books and saying, oh, verification ka case hai na, oh, verification ka case law. And some 10 judgments, Zia and I looked at each other, ke baap re, what are we going to do tomorrow? What verification is this? There's some blessed verification saying that it's a whatever it was to personal knowledge or not to personal, to from the record, etc., etc. But for some reason, Ram would just not look at the facts. He only asked for this blessed verification judgments, and he kept saying, "Show me these verification judgments. Supreme Court ne ye bola hai, wo bola hai. Can verification be cured? Can verification not be cured? Is it an incurable thing? This that." He must have looked at about 15 judgments. As I said, out of the 3 hours, 2.5 hours, he looked only at verification. We left his chamber thinking that tomorrow we are going to get finished in court. It was before Justice Ashok Agarwal in court, what is now courtroom 21. It used to be originally the Prothom Notary's office and is now courtroom 21. And Mr. Cooper was on the other side, Khatu Cooper, another great lawyer who simplified matters in a manner in which nobody else did. And when Khatu got up and said that, you know, this is oppression, gross mismanagement, fraud, Ram said, I have a preliminary objection. Look at his verification clause. And he expounded on that verification clause for about 15 to 20 minutes, at the end of which the other side said, we'll withdraw our petition and take liberty to file a fresh petition. But that was the genius of the man, you know. I mean, and at the end of it, I mean, we had to concede that although the conference was exceptionally boring, we almost fell asleep, it worked for the client. And sorry, if you'll forgive me, one more story of involving Mr. Sathe's. Sorry, am I exceeding my time? Mr. Sathe's colleague, Mr. D.H. Mehta, we were arguing a matter before Justice Pinse and Justice Madan. Justice Madan was the senior judge. And we all thought that the two were extreme poles apart. You know, Justice Madan was very thorough. It took him 10 minutes to just go through the title to ascertain that everybody was there, all the parties were there. And it took Justice Pinse 10 seconds to say that all the parties were okay. You know, sort of, it reminds you of what Ray Robinson once said of Vijay Merchant and Mushtaq Ali in cricket, where he said that, you know, Mushtaq Ali was the flamboyant and Merchant was the stodgy sort of chap. And he said they are as different in style as curry is from rice, but just as effective in combination. And when you think of it, it's they were a superb bench. Anyway, we had some, Mr. D.H. Mehta was arguing for the appellant. I was raw junior again for the respondent, some arbitration matter. And the bench was against him. But I thought I'll show my knowledge of things, that I had also read the law. So I would get up every 5 minutes or something and say, no, that's wrong. The Calcutta judgment, the Calcutta High Court has taken this view and this court has taken this view. After my third interruption, Justice Madan turned to me and said, Mr. Devitri, we are with you. We are against him. Do you know the first rule of advocacy? So I said, no, I don't think so. He said, the first rule of advocacy is that when a judge is with you, counsel sits down. So that one had to keep my mouth shut and we had to sit down. I must tell you that I also was a professor at Government Law College at some time with Milind. I was asked to teach tax, of which I knew nothing. Milind was a superb professor of constitutional law, and Snehal Paranjpe was also there. And we used to go to each other's classes and sit in each other's classes as if we were students. And I once went to Milind's class in JLC. Some chap came next to me and said, hey, you're new, huh, here, you haven't been attending. So I said, no, yaar, I don't come to court and all that. So he said, yeah, professor acha hai. So I said, yeah, he seems to be good. And later, I learned that that fellow was also a student in my class, but had obviously never attended my lecture. Well, we had to, I frankly had to give it up, because in those days also, at the time when we were lecturing, Justice Dowd had started the Wami Mystery Trial, the Keshavani Society Trial, and I think some of you, Nitin, or probably was there at that time. And he used to have the evidence recorded every day from 9:30 in the morning. If you think that Justice Kathawala is the first to sit outside court hours, you're sadly mistaken. Justice Dowd used to sit sometimes at 9 o'clock, sometimes at 9:30. And we had examined, as one of our witnesses, Mr. Soli Sorabji, who came into the witness box. We had Mr. Fali Nariman leading us with Mr. Rafiq Dada, myself, Mr. Zaiwala, my senior. And Soli Sorabji came into the box for a very interesting reason. The suit had been filed first in the City Civil Court. And Justice Suresh then, or just Judge Suresh of the City Civil Court, said no jurisdiction and threw it out from there. So it was refiled in the Bombay High Court, claiming Section 14, bona fide in a court without jurisdiction. Now, in those days, it was thrown out because it said that under some court fees act amendment had just come in. 6A14 was that section of the act for were not capable of monetary relief. And the allegation on the other side was that this was counsel's negligence, that counsel had not looked at it properly, and the person who had settled the plaint was Mr. Sorabji. So we called Mr. Sorabji and said, come and explain why you filed it in the allegation on the other side was that the plaintiff, our client, was very, very friendly with Mr. Sorabji, and therefore he had been negligent and sort of, you know, just done it in a friendly kind of way. And when he was in the box, the first question put to him was, how intimate were your relations with the plaintiff? And Soli visibly blanched, you know, you could see. But he came up with a superb answer. He said, you know, they were very close. Our relations were very close. The plaintiff could walk into my chamber at any time, but I could throw him out also at any time. And the judge took all that down I must also say, as has been said in passing, that I had the advantage, so to speak, of being a commentator, a cricket commentator, when I joined the bar. I mean, I started my commentary in 1972. I still remember 6th and 7th of April 1972 was my first Ranji Trophy commentary in radio. And in 1973, it was my first test match commentary. And then after that, there were a whole series of test matches and ODIs. And in that sense, it was an advantage in the sense that the judges before whom you appeared felt that they had a familiar face before them. Some of them professed to be fans. Because of sports roundup and whatever. But it never affected their judgment, it never affected their decision. And I think all it did was that they dismissed my matters with a smile rather than with a frown. That was the only difference to my mind that it made to them. And I think as we progress down this journey, and I suppose the journey must come to an end at some stage, I think the next, after the decision as to whether to become, go on with the solicitor's firm or to become counsel, the next major decision, it can be a life-changing decision, is when do you apply for your senior gown? Some of you have just experienced it very recently. And I think it was at a stage when, in passing, I must tell you that at some stage in my life, in my profession, Goa happened to me. And I remember the first time that my wife and I went to Goa, we stayed in some very cheapy hotel, because in those days, you didn't have too much money, you looked for cheapy hotels. And we had Mr. Azim at JRD, who knew almost every secretary of government of Maharashtra, and would get us these government bungalows, which were very nice, not five-star posh, but very cheap. So you opted for the cheapest bungalow sort of, because you didn't have to pay too much. I remember in those days, Temtan Andhyarujana had signed my form for Bombay Gymkhana for 3,000 rupees membership, sports membership, under 30 membership. This must have been in 70, it must be in 80 or something. And I couldn't tell Temtan that I'm sorry, I can't become a member, because I just didn't have the money. I didn't have 3,000 rupees to become a member of a leading gymkhana in Bombay. But when Goa happened, we would sort of go to these five-star hotels, outside these five-star hotels, like Taj had just come up, Aguada. And we'd wonder, you know, maybe someday we'll come and stay here kind of thing. And then as it happened in the mid-1990s, Goa virtually became my second home. I was at Siddharth for about 15 days in the month. All these mining matters were there. And Goa became a very pleasant aspect of my professional career. And I remember one day we came back from Goa, and in the chambers we were complaining, so you go all the way there. In those days you had to go one day, only one Indian Airlines flight. There was no other. Today you have 9 flights and all full. You had to go one day, have your matter the next day, and come back the third day because the flight was in the morning. And he came back and was complaining in chambers, saying that, "Arey, you go all the way there," and then the matter got adjourned. And one of our seniors said, "Listen, don't keep complaining. If you have a matter here in Bombay or in the High Court, it's very important that you reach. That the matter reaches. If you have a matter outside the High Court, out of Bombay, it's very important that the matter reaches. It doesn't matter that you reach. It doesn't matter whether the matter reaches or not." And he gave us very sage advice on that aspect of it. And you know, after you become a senior, I must tell you, and this may be of interest to you, Biren, my application for seniority was deferred. And I recall when the results came out, and I think Nitin was a part of the of that group. I was shattered, frankly. I was dejected. I mean, it was one of the most depressing moments of my professional career. I said to myself, I've been offered a judgeship, so I'm considered good enough to be a judge, but why is my application for seniority deferred? I was told there was a technical glitch, and I must say his father, who was then a senior judge, administrative judge, called me to his chamber and told me, "Beta, there is some problem, there was some technical glitch. The next slot, you are 100% going to be confirmed." And sure enough, in the matter of 3 months or so after that deferral, but for the first time in my professional career, I thought I must quit the profession because there was no point in my continuing if my own court didn't think that I was fit enough to be a senior. And once you become a senior, I think, you know, the responsibility increases. Judges, some judges treat seniors or propositions coming from seniors a little more differently, a little differently from those that come from juniors. I remember before a judge in court three, I won't name him. Jai Chennai was on the other side. We were arguing some summons for judgment, and I made a particular point, huge claim against us. It would have finished my client. And the judge just wouldn't accept the proposition. The attorney got a little nervous, so he briefed my senior, Bami Zaiwala, who came the next day, made the identical proposition. And the judge readily accepted it. So we came back to chambers and he said, "Why, what did I say wrong?" Sort of, you know, it led you into a state of wonderment. I said exactly what you said. And he said, "Ye toh abe dikra tha hai hum, judges sometimes are." And when we were discussing this, Rohit Kapadia tells us that, you know, 20 years ago, I had the identical experience before Justice Mukhi, where in his chambers we had a matter. I made a particular proposition. Justice Mukhi just rejected it out of hand. So the attorney briefed J.I. Mehta. J.I. Mehta came the next day, made the identical proposition, and the judge said, "Yes, yes, I must accept this." And to put a spin to it, I recall that Justice Nariman, when he was here, was arguing a matter before Justice Bharucha. And of course, he was a junior then. And Justice Bharucha just would not accept a particular proposition. So like has happened, it seems to have been happening, maybe happening even today. They briefed R.J. Joshi, Gaurav's father, delightful man. And he came the next day and he argued this before Justice Bharucha, made the same proposition. And Justice Bharucha again accepted it. R.J. Joshi in fact got up and told Justice Bharucha that, "Look, I don't know, you're accepting this, but let me tell you that I have not said one word different from what this young junior argued yesterday." So, you know, these things happen. It happened with me and my junior JP, where before Justice Lodha, Justice Lodha dismissed Rashmi's matter. Justice Lodha dismissed some company petition because you had to annex the notice under 434, which was sent to the registered office of the company. If it was not to the registered office, your petition doesn't lie. We had sent it to the registered office and also to some central office, but unfortunately we had annexed the central office letter. So he dismissed it. They all came saying, please come, by now we were seniors. And we appeared before Justice Lodha, and Justice Lodha said, "Oh, that matter that I dismissed, all right, restored." And you know, this happens from time to time. I mean, I suppose you can take a few liberties when you're a senior. I was briefed by Wadia Gandhi in a matter in the Dindoshi court about 10 years ago. And there was a judge there who was regarded as being the pense of the court, in the sense that he heard matters and finished them very fast. So he said,
you people come from the High Court and take up my whole board. I'm not going to let you argue for very long. Tell me, how long will you take? And I very innocently and not in a combative way, I said, as long as it takes me for making you understand what I'm saying. And there was pin drop silence in court, you know. And then, I mean, he took it well because he allowed me to argue as long as I wanted. And I suppose I could go on and on in these sort of little experiences that we've had in court. And I suppose the journey continues, but I assume that this talk must come to an end. So I must thank all of you for listening to me very patiently. If you have any questions, I'd be more than happy to answer them. Thank you.